Hello everybody and welcome to ACU North Sydney. We have colleagues here from overseas, from Melbourne, from Brisbane, and anywhere else? Adelaide? Around the corner. Very important neighbours. It's terrific that you could join us on such a cold evening here in North Sydney. It always seems to be about 3 degrees colder here. But those of us who were attending the wonderful IFCU conference in Melbourne last week feel that we're now experiencing summer. It was so darn cold, but it was a wonderful occasion. So it's a very big year for ACU. This is our 25th anniversary of this wonderful university. And I look around the room and I guess there could be some people who've been here for the whole of the 25 years. Would that be correct? Yes, there are. And so it's a wonderful occasion to celebrate not only the people who've made this university what it is today, but also the people who are helping reconstitute it for the future. And as you know, the industry of higher education is reconstituting so rapidly, we don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. Ministers of states and federal government have enormous power and they are using that at the moment. But we in this university are grounded. The establishment of the La Salle Academy of Religious Education and Faith Formation, or the other way around, is it Faith Formation and Religious Education, is a wonderful concept. And it's a concept that's central to the heart of ACU. So to celebrate both the establishment of the La Salle Academy and the 25th year anniversary, the Faculty of Education and Arts would like to join in the celebrations. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Tanya Aspland. I have the privilege of being the Executive Dean of the Faculty of Education and Arts, a fairly recent restructure within the university, and some people tell me even a revisiting of a structure that we had some time ago. So you never know what's around the corner. My colleague Lauren Stevenson took us through afternoon tea and read, gave us a lovely narrative around the establishment of ACU here at North Sydney. And it's certainly an impressive one. So tonight really is one of celebration. Our Associate Vice Chancellor, Professor Maria Nicholson, is here in the front row. She doesn't have a job, and I think it's the first event that I've ever been to that Maria hasn't had a job. So would you like to welcome Maria as she relaxes this evening? We have various other dignitaries in the room with us. Professor Anne Cummings, who is our DVC Students Learning and Teaching. Welcome, Anne. Thank you very much. I know you've been leading the charge on the 25th celebrations, and it's wonderful that you could join us. You're probably over the celebrations by now. And I'm sure you noticed the foyer as you came in this evening and the celebrations of our history as a Catholic university. But it is important that we respect the elders of the land on which we meet this evening, and we like to start the evening with the acknowledgement of those ancestors, and I would ask Russell Smith to come to the podium, please, to make the acknowledgement. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Russell Smith. I'm a cultural mentor in Yarralinga. I'm actually a Ngarrindjeri man, which is the Ngarrindjeri people, if there is anyone from South Australia, the Ngarrindjeri people are from the Coorong, which is about 2 hours southeast of Adelaide. It's a beautiful country, rather windswept and cool, but beautiful nonetheless. Tonight, Cassandra and I have actually changed things a little bit in regards to an acknowledgement of country, and we're kind of hoping that in doing that, that it inspires you to be able to do this yourself as well, especially in any kind of gathering that you are proceeding or taking place in doing. So I'm going to give you a really, the big version, but it is, I can't reiterate enough how easy it is for anyone, whether they be Aboriginal or non-Aboriginal, to do. It takes Google and a couple of words, that's it. All you've got to work out is who's the mob that you want to talk about and thank them for allowing you to be in their country. But this is the big version. Aboriginal Australians are the oldest continuing surviving living cultures in the entire world. We as Australians have a privilege of walking forward as a nation in the footsteps of its traditional custodians, sharing in our knowledge, cultures and traditions. Our people have walked this country for over 60,000 years with trust and respect, with protocols, with rituals and ceremonies, giving thanks to the Creator, to our ancestors who walk with us in this journey, to our Father in the sky and our Mother in the earth who nourishes us. It is in traditional times when our people travelled from one country to another, whether it be they might be travelling through country and they might be travelling through country to go through and see somebody else, or they actually might be just going to country because things are a bit scarce where they are. And what they would do is they would go to the border of that country, and that the border of the country might be a tree or a rock or a waterway or whatever. And they'd light a fire and they'd wait. And then they'd wait a bit longer and probably wait some more. And then eventually someone from that country would see that fire and they'd head over and ask them why they're there. Those people would state the reasons why they're there, and then that message would be taken back to the elders and it was either granted or denied. When granted, a ceremony was given to cleanse the spirits, inviting the ancestors of country to look after them and to guide them and keep them safe on their journey. When we speak culture and story. We're also calling in the old people, the ancestors, to hear what we are speaking. So what is spoken needs to be of value and respect. A welcome to country, as I said before, can only be done by an elder or a custodian of that country. An acknowledgement of country recognises the unique position of Aboriginal people in Australian culture and history, and shows respect for Aboriginal peoples, both past and present. Acknowledging country is about paying respect in a contemporary fashion. It is a way that the wider community can demonstrate respect for Aboriginal protocols and can be performed, as I said before, by anyone, by any individual, whether they be Aboriginal or non-Aboriginal. The most wonderful thing I think about being involved in this ritual is you yourself get to be part of a ritual that is thousands and thousands and thousands of years old. And that is an amazing thing. It is an acknowledgement that the past to the past as much as it is about looking to the future with a gift of generosity. A generosity that despite hundreds of years of trauma, Aboriginal people as a whole still have this amazing generosity to share of self, of culture, traditions, and a willingness to walk this country in our journey forward together. In sharing this, I would like to acknowledge country. I would like to acknowledge the Noongar country from WA in which my mother resides. And I would also like to acknowledge the Ngarrindjeri country, the country of my father and my country. I would like to acknowledge and pay my respects to the Darug, the Gwigal, Gadigal, Darawal and Guringai countries on the lands I work and live. I would like to pay my respects again and acknowledge this country, Guringai country. I acknowledge country and show my respects to the stories that this country continues to hold of its custodians. I acknowledge the old people, our ancestors, who even though we don't see them through the concrete and the buildings, we know that they are still present with us in the earth beneath our feet, in the rocks, in the waterways, and the animals around us. I acknowledge the elders, the keepers of our ancient stories, the holders of cultural knowledge, and the teachers of our cultural ways. In continuing ACU's commitment to reconciliation and in line with Aboriginal and Torres Strait Island tradition, it is customary to acknowledge country as we pass through. Today, we acknowledge and pay our respects to the elders, to the First Peoples, the traditional custodians of the lands and waterways, and thank them for their continued hospitality. Let us walk this path forward together so that we are able to embrace change whilst at the same time holding on to the essential essence of what makes our beautiful country a unique and wonderful place to be. Let us share in the ancient cultures of this land before they are stories on walls of art galleries and museums. As a Ngarrindjeri man, I ask you this evening to walk this story with me and my people, and whilst you are on your own journey of change. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Russell, for the deep and insightful acknowledgement of country, a protocol which is central to the mission of ACU. So thank you very much. Our senior staff of the university, members of Senate who are present here this evening, distinguished guests, our CEO partners, I see a number of you here, which is wonderful that you could join us, staff and students who are present this evening. I'd like to introduce our guest speaker for this evening, Dr. David Hall. I better turn to my notes. David is a terrific friend of ours. Oops. And we spent a lot of time together last week at IFCU throwing around some of the key concerns. Sorry, David. The key concerns around Catholic education and around our mission together as partners in Catholic education. David is a Marist brother and is currently the Foundation Dean of La Salle Academy for Faith Formation and Religious Education at ACU, as I mentioned before. And many of the members of the Academy are present here tonight in support of the work that David's doing. Prior to his appointment at ACU, David spent 30 years, and it's hard to believe because he's such a youthful looking chap, as a practitioner in the Catholic education sector. He's been a principal of several Catholic schools, primary and secondary, co-educational and single sex. David's also involved in the governance of independent Catholic schools as a member of boards and councils, and also conducts workshops and other professional learning activities in the areas of spiritual formation and leadership. At the present time, and this is really testament to the type of work that David does, he's leading an extensive professional development program for Catholic school leaders across 22 countries in Africa. And we're about to lose him to Africa for the next month as he completes that work. It's appropriate for David to address this topic tonight because his doctoral dissertation from the Catholic Theological Union in Chicago is entitled Forming Australian Catholic School Leaders in Uncertain Times, Friends of a Compelling God. So last week at IFCU, I have to say, David presented on behalf of ACU in an international forum, probably the best or one of the best papers at the conference, and challenged people to think deeply about this topic in such uncertain and modern and challenging times. So I'm sure David's going to stimulate your minds this evening, as he did last week, and promote plenty of discussion, to which we've allocated about 20 minutes after his presentation. So without anything further ado, may I welcome you to the podium, my friend, David Hall.
Thank you very much, Tanya, and thanks, folks, for coming along this evening. It's an interesting thing to do in the 25th year of ACU as someone who has an academic transcript from everything ACU ever was, from the Catholic College of Education, from Paulding College, from the Catholic College of Education Sydney, and from ACU. It actually looks like I failed at many institutions and eventually ended up with a degree. So it's very interesting to be giving this evening. For those of you who have heard me speak on this before, our little video introduction may be familiar to you. Stay with me because we take another direction this evening. Let's have a look at the video.
Remember how we laughed away the hours and dreamed of all the great things.
And as we move into this talk now, can I welcome our colleagues to or at our other venues around the country. We have our colleagues from a number of the other campuses of the university joining us by video this evening. So welcome to our colleagues around the country. You might wonder why I showed you that video. Why show you pictures of what is no more? It's less than 1%, I think, of religious who now occupy any position in Catholic schools. But I think it's something to teach us for this evening and of the ecclesiology, which says something about what is still held in Catholic education and the church in this country and in the Western world, from which we must learn if we are to have an ecclesial future for our Catholic schools. It's interesting from that video to think that era is well and truly gone, but you know, It's in our very, very recent memory. This building here of the Morris Brothers in Western Sydney in Dundas was opened in 1957. Double brick, silky oak, it was to last 200 years. Double brick, silky oak, 200 years. It's actually now occupied by the Scientologists, but that's another story. What the Morris do for money is immoral, but anyway. The interesting part about it was a sensible thing to build at the time because every year, this group of people who were going to teach in Catholic schools were leaving from the novitiate to go off to their teacher training college. 1957, 80 bedrooms every year, built for 200. Only 25 years later, only one quarter of a century later, only 1/8 of the time that the building was built for, not this group, but this group, arrived for training in that house. And this is testament to what religious life does to you, because this was one of the me, and look at it now. Any wonder no one's joining? But there were no more people to come. The statue of Mary was removed, the building was sold, it was all over. What we had in those days, of course, was an ecclesial workforce. They were there, in numbers, as a workforce for the church. My suggestion to you this evening, ladies and gentlemen, is that while Catholic school staff no longer look like that, and more of them look like this, perhaps we need to be careful to remind ourselves that they are no longer just an ecclesial workforce. But perhaps, I believe, there is a danger that we still see it that way. Let's explore a little further what I mean by that. because it's represented for us in this ancient etching. There they all are. The Holy Father in the centre, the cardinals are the side, the bishops are the side of that, the priests a little lower down, the religious sisters kneeling, and the lay people bowing. There it all is, captured as a church should be. I'd like to suggest to you that while it's not exactly like that now, we're not far away from it, and we're to embrace another future if our Catholic schools are to be ecclesial into the future. What do I mean by an ecclesial workforce? It comes out of a classical theology which Mary Froelich would describe this way. A lay disciple is called to accept a peripheral and submissive role within the church while taking an active role in the transformation and nature of history. That's what Catholic school teachers and leaders do. Take on a transformational role in the nature of history. But do they in fact contribute to the building up to the nature of the church and its future in very real and deep ways? My question is, where are they in the decision making about what the church looks like, and how are they contributing to helping Catholics as parents and students in their schools have their own ecclesial identity? Our friend at the Catholic Institute, David Ranson, suggests that we are in a period where the past is known but is no longer instrumental, and where the future is intuited but is yet to be realised with effective agency. My spin on Ranson is that the past has never been less instructive, and the future has never been less certain. I'm not suggesting, folks, that we can't learn from the past. I'm not suggesting that the past hasn't got something to teach us, but it doesn't instruct us in the way that we did. When I took up my first principalship, and my colleague Dan White was principal of another school across the way, and Anne Benjamin was deputy executive director of schools at the time, I basically did what those before me did. And I was starting to be encouraged to go in another direction. Take over a school now, I would suggest, and you can't do what they did before you. We are in very interesting times. So who will lead tomorrow's Catholic schools? Well, around the issue of schools, one thing is critical. Forget about the Catholic for the moment. Let's go to the Aitzel standards and say, if you can't do these things, get out of the game. You have to lead teaching and learning. You have to be able to lead to develop yourself and others. You have to be able to lead for improvement, innovation and change. You have to be able to lead the management of a school, and you have to be able to engage in working with the community. If we can't do that, we should get out of the game. For this evening's address, that's a given. Everybody should be able to do that. But what about the Catholic bit? What does it mean to lead a Catholic school at the present time? Well, it's an interesting thing if we have a look at a recently released book by our colleagues that said, will Catholic schools be Catholic in 2030? It certainly begs the question or the concern that they won't be, doesn't it? That they might not be in 2030. And of course, Catholic schools at the crossroads, which of course remains a very significant document for us, even though it's a few years old now, was written on the very basis that there was a fear that Catholic schools would not have their identity and the focus on mission into the future. Around the issue of leadership that we're gathered around tonight, it speaks very, very significantly. And it speaks across a range of things. 8 suggestions about how to focus on the identity issue. 9 suggestions on how to focus on the issues of new evangelisation. 18 suggestions on passing on Catholic faith, life and culture. 6 on leading and staffing a school. And 15 critical indicators of what the progress will look like. Around the issue of leadership, saying that all principals, assistant principals and RECs will be practicing Catholics who understand and profess the Catholic faith, model it in their lives and teach it effectively. Progress towards an increase in the proportion of school staff who are practicing and knowledgeable Catholics. At the application and appointment to a new position, and at other appropriate occasions, leaders and staff are reminded of the Catholic identity and mission of the school under the expectation that they will commit themselves to that mission. Written because there was a concern that that was not going to happen. My observation would be that it's happening pretty well. But there's another step. There's somewhere else to go if we're going to depth this ecclesial identity, and that's what I would like to explore with us this evening. Around four challenges that come to us from the Council for Research and Values in Philosophy, I think these are key challenges for us in Australia today in the leadership of Catholic schools. Four of them. One, that many seekers of the Spirit have left ecclesial practice. Isn't that the mantra of our era? I'm spiritual but not religious. Number two, the model of exercising church magisterium is being challenged. It's being explored and it's being discerned. Number three, the content of moral teaching of the church is not only in dialogue, but it's being challenged too. And number four, there is a pluralism of spiritualities within our Catholic tradition. I'm not suggesting about other traditions, about other faiths. I'm talking about the pluralism of spiritualities within our own tradition, which is indeed causing us some challenges and some tensions. Let's have a look at each of these for one moment. What do I mean by many seekers of the Spirit have left ecclesial practice? Have you read Roy Williams' post-God Nation, only released very recently, looking at the situation of religion in Australia? Religion in Australia is no longer socially significant. No longer. That's not to say religious institutions are not doing significant work. Look at the great social welfare of the Catholic Church. Look at health in the Catholic Church. Look at aged care in the Catholic Church. Education in the Catholic Church. But in terms of the lives of individual people, most Australians show scant interest in the Church's opinions or activities. And I think that that's fairly true of most of the Western world. It's interesting, Timothy Dolan, the Archbishop of New York, suggested this in an article I read recently. He said, "The greatest threat to the Church is not heresy, dissent, secularism or moral relativism, but the sanitised, feel-good, boutique, therapeutic spirituality," he suggests. A therapeutic spirituality, Tim Dolan says, that makes no demands, calls for no sacrifices, asks for no conversion, and it's simply about soothing and affirming. Very interesting understanding, is it not, of the place of religion in our country where spirituality has replaced religion. Let's take a look at this second one here. The mode of exercising church magisterium is being challenged, explored, and discerned. There is no question about that happening quite significantly in spades in this country. Only recently, John Allen, you know the great church commentator John Allen, if you don't know him, read him. Perhaps the best, I believe, in the Catholic Church, commenting on the Catholic Church internationally. Recently, a couple of years ago, released a book, The Future of the Church. It's an excellent précis on where we should be heading and what we should be attending to. John's an interesting man. Published in Crooks, he wrote an article about his interview with the Archbishop of Sydney, Anthony Fisher, about Cardinal George Pell. Fascinating interview and worth reading. And in that interview, all sorts of things come up that we would never have happened to us not very long ago. This is Archbishop Fisher says, a lot of people didn't like him for the very strong conservative stand he took on a number of issues, and they would be happy to see him humbled, said Fisher. Fisher said there's also a personal edge to the anti-Pell sentiment. Probably some people too are looking for public contrition. They think George looks too self-confident or too gruff or too defiant. There's a kind of Aussie male macho element about his whole demeanour they don't like. Folks, I'm not reading it to you to suggest I agree with it one way or the other, but simply to say that not very long ago, these sorts of commentaries about the place of our church magisterium weren't happening. And now they are. It's very, very interesting how it's all playing out. The thing I learned, of course, is that in it all, we need to be fair, charitable, and frank. And that's what I think the current Archbishop of Sydney did in his comments to John Allen. He was fair, he was charitable, and he was frank. And so there's a good learning out of it. But what about what's happening here in the man who walked away from the job you just don't walk away from? These people couldn't believe it. And what did the Holy Father say recently on this whole matter? He says, there should be a time limit to positions in the church. Be careful if you've gone up for contract renewal. There should be a time limit to positions in the church, which in reality are positions of service, says the Holy Father to us. A whole new agenda in that regard. And what about this third issue, the content of moral teaching? There's a lot of dialogue around it, and it's under challenge. The don't mess with marriage statement that was released by our bishops with good intent was not received warmly by everybody. There was the petition from a student in a Catholic school, asked for signatures to remove the ignorant and anti-gay propaganda from circulation in Australian schools regarding same-sex marriage. Not so long ago, these sorts of responses would not have happened, and they're happening to us now. The fear, the danger, is to speak louder and to speak harder and with a heavier hand, but it doesn't work. So what does this mean for the leaders in our Catholic schools? Who will they be, and what will they do with this? When this document was released, no less to me than 15 phone calls from colleagues in Catholic schools across the countries, what would you do with it? Not because they wanted to do the wrong thing, not because of that, but because they had a pastoral sense of the impact that it might have. And so they asked the question. Others wouldn't accept it like this. Or the story of the others who set it alight. Not so very long ago, these things didn't happen. But they're happening to us now. And it's important for us to consider what we do with this and how we can continue to respond to it all. It happened also, didn't it, to Archbishop Porteous in Tasmania, where it was ramped up even further. And threats that what he had done would be taken to the anti-discrimination level, at the civil level in the country. And so Archbishop Porteous made I don't know if you've seen his video, he tried to make a very concerted response to explain why. But not so very long ago, this wasn't happening to us. But it is now. And what about the pluralism of spiritualities within our tradition? What do I mean by that? What about what happened in the USA around the issue of Congress's decision to legalise same-sex marriage? What happened in the church in the USA? It's remarkable when you look at the breadth of responses that happened within the episcopacy and the ordained. The president of the Catholic Bishops Conference said that it was profoundly immoral and unjust, and it was a tragic error. Archbishop Sean O'Malley, who's the Archbishop of Boston and on Pope Francis's Cardinals of Nine group, said he was saddened about it. And Archbishop Blaise Kupuch, who is the Archbishop of Chicago, said, this is now about a real welcome for same-sex people. The respect must be real, and it must not be rhetorical. Can you see the difference in the response of these three men, all ordained bishops of the church, all in good standing with Rome, all members of the bishops' conference, all with different responses, all valid. And then further still, if we look at a fairly significant commentary that came from Daniel Horan, a fairly well-known priest in the USA, who said, my personal response was emotional in the way that the reaction of so many others has been in the wake of this landmark case. What an extraordinary range of responses that happens amongst the episcopacy and the ordained within one country. And what do you do with that if you're a Catholic school leader? Well, depends who your bishop is, I suppose. That has partly to do with it. But it is a challenge to decide what you do with it as a Catholic school leader. Or what of this challenge that's playing itself out over the Synod on the Family? Cardinal Burke, who has already announced that there is may well be that he'll have to disagree with the Pope, and Cardinal Caspar, who was the one who gave Pope Francis the book on mercy that he read during the conclave. Two very different views within the one spirituality, two very different spiritualities, I beg your pardon, within the one tradition. Peter Steinfels, in his book, A People Adrift, said, "Stop thinking about Catholic identity as though this was something univocal. There may be some overarching principles, but there is no single way of embodying them. And it might be wiser to speak of Catholic identities in the plural." Now, there's a key to who we should be into the future. The plurality of leadership around the breadth of a tradition which includes so many. And that, I think, is an insight into who we should be. The late Michael Putney had a very interesting statement around this, and he said, "Identity is shaped not only by one's own tradition, but also by engagement with the other, which in this case is a multifaceted other, including other Christians, other believers, and above all, the secular postmodern culture of Australian today." That's breadth, isn't it? From a bishop who sees it not only as ecumenical, but multi-faith, and even into the secular culture. The most recent works of Jerry Arbuckle teach us the same thing. If you haven't read him, read him. He's interesting because he says that institutions that refuse to allow their identities to change in view of changing in context cease to exist. And this is my point to us this evening, folks, that if we don't imagine a new ecclesial identity, we just won't exist anymore. A reasonable degree of diversity and dissent is essential for any organisation if it is to have a future. By dissent, I mean simply the proposing of alternatives. And here will come the place for us, for Catholic school leaders into the future. Who will be the people who will propose the alternatives? I think it's going to be the leaders of our Catholic schools, because they are the people who have the pastoral contact with the baptised. There are fewer and fewer who are of pastoral contact through other means. Not that I'm not desiring them, not that we don't desire them, but because that's where they are at the present time. So Pope Francis says to us, well, contribute in many fruitful ways to the concrete realisation of the collegial spirit. And that's who we'll need to be into the future. Collegial leaders, with the magisterium, with the other baptised, that in our collegiality we will find a future as leaders of Catholic schools. Because there's an interesting debate on at the moment, isn't it? Is he that or that? Everyone's asking, aren't they? Is he a liberal or is he a conservative? And he's surprising us all the time. And interesting statement, I think, on reflection that Francis Campbell had on the Irish situation in relation to this. He says, "Today's Ireland seems quite similar to the past, an unthinking and dogmatic form of liberalism seems to have replaced an unthinking form of Catholicism." And we're potentially in that space, unthinking dogmatics and unthinking liberals. That sort of binary thinking will do us nothing for the future. It will do us nothing. So we need to get ourselves out of the debate of is it this or this, and understand that the range of voices will contribute to the building up of the reign of God in the world. That's our job, I believe. You take the situation in Ireland, for example, and no one imagined that would happen the way it did they? That a plebiscite of a Catholic country would indicate that the people there now believe that same-sex marriage is the same as heterosexual marriage. It's taken everybody quite by surprise. But interestingly enough, Cardinal Dermot Martin, the Archbishop of Dublin, said, "We need to have robust discussions and challenge one another, and we are not doing that. We are becoming a church of the like-minded and a safe space for the like-minded, rather than the Pope, the church Pope Francis is talking about." There's the challenge. No longer the space for the like-minded, but the space for the dialogue, dialogue in truth. And that's what I think will give us a chance at a future. So what will a Catholic school leader look like? What should they do? Who should they be? They have to know the tradition. There's no way you can lead if you don't know the tradition you're leading in. Number two, they have to know where they situate themselves. Because not every Catholic agrees 100% with everything that some people say is 100% Catholic. Only in the tablet popped in my tray today. There it is. Married priests, the bishops speak out in support. Retired bishops of the UK, it's time for married priests. So it's important that Catholic school leaders, whoever they are, know where they situate themselves. I'm not suggesting that they should then indulge themselves and then share their views with everyone and impose them on them. No, that's not our place. Because if we have a teaching place in the church, we have to honour the tradition. But we at least have to know where we stand. What do I mean by that? If you tell a science teacher that they have to tell their kids what the church's teaching is on something, then they'll tell them. Will the kids embrace it? No. And are they likely to reject it? Yes, if they're told by the teacher that way. But someone who knows where they stand on something can still faithfully deliver the tradition as long as they know where they stand themselves. And there are many other more vexed and controversial issues I could have chosen than the safe one of married priests. Important. Then, of course, leaders have to know their responsibilities. We're all given responsibilities in our appointments within the church, and we need to know them. And then we need to know our people. It's very different leading different people in different places, isn't it? Different people will require different things of us. That's critical for us. We must know our people. And lastly, in this list, Catholic school leaders must imagine a new reality. We cannot stay in our current reality. It will not bring about the reign of God in the way we at least understand it at the moment. Too much lamentation of what we haven't got, and not enough imagination about what God might want. I'll come back to how you know what God wants in a moment, because I think I know. And I'm not Jesuit. So what will we want of them? Three things. They will need to be thinking people. If they're not thinking people, they can't lead Catholic schools. Number two, they must be articulate people. If you cannot speak about the tradition, if you cannot debate about the tradition, if you cannot dialogue in the tradition, you cannot lead it. And number three, they must be engaged. Engaged with the tradition themselves as people of witness and faith, and engaged with the people they lead. Otherwise, not a chance. Tell me, have you read this book? The Husband's Secret. Go and read it. It's a great secret. And not a secret you'd want your husband to have, I might add. Very, very interesting book. Picked it up when I was rushing through the airport, and bag full of ACU paperwork, all ready to read on the flight from Sydney to Dubai, and thought, oh, forget that. And I went into the shop and I thought, I'll buy number one, and it wasn't there, and this was number two. The Husband's Secret. The intertwined, interwoven lives of a group of people around a Catholic parish and a Catholic primary school. I'm trying to work out which one it is. Set in Sydney. I think I've picked the principal, actually. But a fascinating story. But one of the characters in it, and it's her husband who has the secret, and she finds out the secret. Whew. And he's trying to make sense of the secret. And she's pretty top-notch. She's president of the PNF, Catholic primary school, president of the PNF, sort of person that father rang up and said, look, would you please come to the funeral of sister on the week, coming up in the week, because we're a bit worried not enough people will come. Very dutiful Catholic, on, as I said, on the PNF, goes to all the school things, mass on Sunday and everything. And then she's confronted with her husband's secret, and he's trying to work out what this means for the, because it's pretty serious, trying to work out what it means for their future. And then she says this, he was referring to God in a chillingly familiar way. They weren't that type of Catholics. They were Catholics, sure. They went to church, but heavens above, they weren't religious. God didn't come into their day-to-day conversation. I think our classical theology religion has done that to people. We can be part of a religious group, but are we people who engage with God? And that will be a very, very critical thing for our leaders of the future. What do I mean by that? I mean by a Catholicity the way Gerald Grace describes it. The Catholicity is the distinctive spiritual, religious, and cultural habitus in which the presence of God is encountered. So there are all the first things we want to see in Catholic schools around the very clear things of identity, the crucifixes, the artwork, the prayer rooms, the attendance at Mass and other sacramental practice, engagement in prayer, engagement in retreats, engagement in solidarity activities. We want to see all of that. But is it also a place of the God encounter? That God is encountered there. And this will be an important role. What I mean by it is that the Catholic faith then will need to be understood as dialogue with God grounded in life, which means that Catholic education will need to be a frame of reference for life, reflecting on the words of everlasting life. Can our Catholic education give our kids a frame of reference? Did you see this movie? Beautiful movie, hey? And as she's looking for her son that, you know, taken from her into adoption, in, and she heads from the United States to Ireland to find her son with Philomena, with this journalist Martin. Pretty bright boy he was, and she was lucky she found him. He was out of a job. They go off to Ireland together to find the son, and start to discover that she'd been lied to, literally lied to, and not just some sort of like appropriate mistelling of the truth, but lied to, and very sad really in lots of ways. And Philomena's Catholic and still Catholic, and Martin was Catholic, and they have an encounter one day in the car. And he basically says, how can you believe in all that mumbo jumbo after what they've done to you? And her response back is, essentially, it's not perfect, but I can't find any other framework by which to live my life. I think that's what our Catholic school leaders have to do. They don't have to pretend that we're presenting a perfect church and a perfect religion, because it's not. It's far from it at the present time. But can they have the capacity and the ability to present the fact that our faith is at least a reasonable framework by which to live our lives? That's what they need to be able to do. And you can't do that if you're not thinking articulate and engaged. Bishop Peter Ingham of Wollongong said to me, David, can we at least get people to understand that it's a reasonable framework? And leave it up to them after that. Because we can't force and coerce, can we? We've tried that. We can't force and coerce, but it has to be at least a reasonable framework. Our friend Andrew Greeley, you know Andrew? Wrote everything from theology to salacious novels, you know? And his very interesting point in his book that he released after the Catechism of the Catholic Church was released, not that he was against the Catechism, but he suggested that the Catechism was a very outward, inward process, and that in fact faith and the growth in faith is an inward, outward process. And he suggests that his aim is to take seriously life's questions and instead of applying religious truths to life, search in life for hints that point to religious truths. We must start with the lives of the individual men and women and children that we serve and help them dialogue with religious truths to make meaning of their lives so that God might reign in the world. It's easy, isn't it? Very, very simple task, and that's what we're called to do. Richard Lenahan, you've read his book, have you? Risking the Church? Superb. Best thing I've read in a long time. It's up to $123 a copy now. You might just want to borrow it from the ACU library. But Richard says, a more positive assessment of present-day culture insists on the possibility of a critical correlation between the Christian tradition and contemporary worldviews. Underpinning this approach is the conviction that the primary concerns of the Christian tradition are reconcilable with the manifestations of the human longing and searching that are prevalent today. You can put the two together. That's going to be the job of the Catholic school leader. That's why we need to have a very clear understanding of ourselves and our ecclesial identity. Very interesting book emerged from Ireland. An interview with 33 men who are priests or were priests. And I think the conclusions of this author have something to say to us about those who should lead Catholic schools. Because David Ranson, in a very interesting article about Catholic schools and reflecting particularly on people in rural regional areas, said they have taken on, in many ways, the pastoral activity of the priest. Certainly that was my experience of it as a Catholic school leader over the years. That the pastoral activity of the principal, the pastoral activity of staff in Catholic schools had moved into a new zone, a new place. And so there are some parallels. We have to uphold the teachings of the church while caring for people whose lives are often at variance with the proclaimed ideal. That's the space. Constantly at variance with the proclaimed ideal. And yet we uphold what we believe. That's going to be our job. Very, very interesting from Clifford Longley on this, and he says, listening to the way the church's mind is working as it asks itself how in the present situation it can be more true to gospel values, but listening also to ordinary people. You see, we're going to, as ecclesial leaders into the future, have to continue to deeply listen to the church because it's changing, and it's changing quickly. Look at the synod coming up, and looking at the divergence of views around the synod, and looking at the anticipation of some that nothing will change, and the anticipation of others that much will change. So we've got to, Catholic school leaders of tomorrow must be deep listeners to the church and deep listeners to the people that they serve. We have to manage to accompany people in all sorts of complicated situations while publicly upholding the teachings of the church. And that's a challenge. That's a very big challenge. But that's why I go back to saying, if you don't know the tradition and you don't know where you stand yourself, then you can't do that. And that's going to be a very, very important thing to do. If we go to the Catholic school on the threshold of the third millennium, it gives it to us very clearly that the school is undoubtedly a sensitive meeting point for the problems which besiege this restless end of the millennium. How's that for us? That we are a sensitive meeting point. So what does that say about the type of leadership it needs to be? It needs to be sensitive and tender. Because that's what we're called to do in Catholic schools at this time. So what do I think it needs? It needs constant discernment. And without constant discernment, we will lose our way or we will lose our voice. And many of us have run the risk over the years of losing our voice, haven't we? So how do you do that? And this is where I come to my final comments for the evening of how do you do that? Well, Karl Rahner was pretty damn clear on it. He said that the devout Christian of the future will either be a mystic or cease to be anything at all. All those mystics in the room, put up your hand. Well done. Thank you, of a couple. We don't easily identify with, do we? And why don't we? Because this is what we're usually used to. That's what they're usually like. Some form of spiritual levitation, you know? Even that the stigmata eventually appears. Hasn't happened to me yet. But that's generally our sense. Certainly not the way Rana understood the mystic, and certainly not the way I understand the mystic. The way I understand it, and what I think the future leaders of Catholic schools need to be, is that they need to be people of reflection, of meditation, and of contemplation. And there is a hierarchy in these things. We can reflect and do all the work and come up with our own answers. Most of the reflection I do is pretty good because it's all my own thoughts and I come up with the answer that I thought everyone should come up with. But if we move ourselves through meditation to contemplation, God does the talking. That's why I was saying before, knowing God's dream. You can know God's dream if you listen deeply enough. And the Christian tradition teaches us that if each individual man and woman listens deeply, then shares what they've heard, then we all hear what God wants. Because when we share what we heard and bring it into dialogue with what the other heard, we come up with an answer. And it's pretty close to God's dream, I think. What is that? It's prayer. If Catholic school leaders of the future are not people of prayer, there will be no Catholic school. They must pray individually and collectively. It is only then that they will hear the voice of God, and it is only then that they can act with any conviction whatsoever. Because left to ourselves, we doubt. And left to ourselves, we are arrogant. And so, let me go here to what the Holy Father is asking of us. He says, what is called for is an evangelization capable of shedding light on these new ways of relating to God, to others, and to the world around us, and inspiring essential values. And we're lucky because it's easier to do with the young than anywhere else. Young people call us to renewed and expansive hope, for they represent new directions for humanity and open us up to the future, lest we cling to a nostalgia for structures and customs which are no longer life-giving in today's world. Very poignant call of the Holy Father about the opportunity we have for those of us who work with young people. And so to conclude, Catholic school leaders of the future must know the tradition. They must know where they situate themselves with that tradition. They must know their responsibilities in their ministerial appointments. They must know the people they serve, and they must imagine a new reality. They will need to think, to articulate, and to engage. But if you take nothing away from tonight, take this away, that they must be people of reflection, meditation, and contemplation. The Catholic school leader of the future will be a person of prayer or not an ecclesial leader at all. Thanks very much, folks.
Thank you, David, for that presentation. And we do have some time for questions now, but I just want to say at the outset, while you're thinking of your question, I think a sign of a great scholar is taking something complex and making it lucid and, in fact, giving us deeper understanding of what it is we're looking at. And I think you've done that tonight, but not without challenges, for sure. I think we appreciate your deep reading, your deep thinking, and the experience that's so deeply embedded behind some of those ideas. So to begin with, thank you for challenging us in the way that you have, and I'm sure those challenges will be reflected in the many questions that people would like to ask you. But we do have about 10 minutes for questions. So would you be prepared to take some questions from the audience? So over to you, folks. Mike is right here.
Acknowledge and give my appreciation for your views about the different perspectives that people will have within the church and the importance of us to be able to be listening to each other and how the duality of being a liberal or a conservative really doesn't help us at this stage. So I appreciate that. Thank you.
Did you ever see that magnificent article? Remember Online Catholics? It used to be an online journal. And there was a bit of a debate going on among Sydney clergy. And John McSweeney, remember Father John McSweeney, the late Father John? Great thinker he was and a man of great charity. And in this debate that was raging amongst the clergy, he spoke about two by name in this article. I won't say them this evening, but he likened it to a family, and he said one was like the child who says, well, that's what mum and dad said, and that's what you do. There's no need for a question. And he said, and there are some of us like that in the church. He says, well, the church teaches that, and that's what you say, and that's what you do. He said, and in the same family, there's the kid that says, why? 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 And he says, and the church is big enough for both of us. And it's a very important thing because, you know, modernity gave us binary thinking. And we need to get rid of that, and because in imagination there is no binary. Thank you, Judith.
Hello. I'm a visitor here. I'm Michael Galgenstrow from Washington, D.C., the United States. I'm the president of the Association of Catholic Colleges and Universities. So you could take a question from across the pond.
I would love to.
So thank you very, very much for the presentation. And I really, really thought you did a fantastic job of both calling all educators to be competent, to listen, to go inside and find out where they really are, and then to take that to prayer, to know, and to be inspired for a new direction. So that's what I take back with me, and I really, really appreciate that. In the middle of the presentation, you touched on the concept that there is unfolding in our church today a whole series of different ways of proceeding, that there's not one spirituality, there are multiple spiritualities. And I would affirm this 100%. And there are. It's a very, society is complicated, but even our church is pretty complicated. So I'm wondering if you maybe could, in the presentation, I think you emphasize that this is a relatively new reality. And I want to expand that a bit and say, is it really an incredibly old reality that we somehow forgot? So when I think of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and Paul, I think they advance a very different way of living Christian faith. Matthew's idea of how to live the law is very different than Mark's idea of Jesus, the human person who is over against everyone in society. There's almost no respect for the law at all in Mark, who Jesus is a bit rambunctious, right? And Luke is telling us that you can be as Jewish as you want and follow the law, but if you forget the poor and women, you have completely missed the boat of what Jesus was here for. So I guess what I'm trying to introduce here is the concept that from the very beginnings of our Christian founding, there was an enormous range of ideas of how to proceed. In fact, it's even held within our canon. So it may have been something we forgot, but I guess I'd like to hear you connect the idea of multiple ideas, multiple spiritualities, and link it to our scriptural roots.
Mm. Thank you for the point. And I make the point as if the church has been that way, because the leaders of tomorrow's Catholic schools, in fact, probably weren't around for Vatican II. So their experience of the church has been one that has been somewhat restorationist over the last three decades. We've got to, the commentaries will continue to emerge on the papacy of John Paul II, who did extraordinary work for the world and the church, but had a particular ecclesiology, which was more about same than it was about broadly different. But take it from a scriptural perspective, yes. I mean, Paul reminds us of the many charisms of all of us who will bring something different. But in addition to that, I think we take it to Jesus and say, isn't it interesting that he says, I came to fulfill the law and the prophets. I came to follow law and love. I mean, we can transfer it way back, take ourselves back to Genesis. And what does God do when God creates the world? But God creates difference. God creates separation. He separates the night from the day. He separates the land from the sea. He makes all sorts of living creatures that walk the earth and teem through the oceans. So indeed, difference is there from the moment of God's breath in the world, you know? So God breathes into the world, you know, and difference is the first thing God does. So yes, it's there for us. It's not been there in our Catholic Church in the last few decades. It's been increasingly about making us the same. And when I say that, there has been some importance about that, and particularly in my experience of Catholic schools, that there was some loss of some of the important things that make for our identity. No question about that. But no question about the absolute need of recognising that God cannot be confined to one point of view. My office wall, there's a saying from a wonderful professor I had that said, God beyond all names, multiply our images of God. And I think that is what our tradition, our Judeo-Christian tradition is all about. So thank you for the comment.
I appreciated your talk well, and you have taken out the instances throughout the world. And it is a trend of the modern world which is going away from the traditional teachings of the church. And as you have explained, from the bishops' attitudes, each one is having his own, and they are not sticking to the original traditional teachings of the church, nor the theological basis. They speak according to the situations. That's why many confusions come, and the people are also nowhere which is to be held up, is there anything certain? So the people are going through that level. And when we look into the life of Christ, we find that Jesus was more understood by St. Paul, who has not heard Jesus directly. But he understood more, and he went to the Gentiles and took them to Jesus. So this is the message the people have to take now if we want to uphold Jesus. And we have to come out of our comfort zones. Bishops are in their own comfort zones. Teachers are in their own comfort zones. And we all the people are in our own comfort zones. And we don't want to take pain to teach the others and to make them really convinced of our religious basis. I think this is the basis where we have to go deep and try to find out some solutions. Thank you.
And I think our leaders are going to have to know what that is, you know. I feel sorry for our bishops at the moment, you know. I feel deeply for them in this space. And one of the things I think we're going to have to do is befriend them more and speak with them more. Because I mostly meet very good bishops and people thinking deeply about what it means to be the people of God. But we just know that saying the same old thing louder and harder doesn't work anymore. We've tried. I used to do it as a school principal, you know. I was a bit soft, you know. And every now and again they'd tell me, you've got to get tough on this. So I got tough, you know. And I told them not to drop the papers, and they didn't for a day. You know, it doesn't work in any respect, does it? So it's getting to the heart of the truth, but that's why our leaders are going to have to know it. That's the importance of theological training. I would love to see an introduction of what I would term modern apologetics. See, apologetics in the Catholic Church has been seen by many to simply have been to be the defence of the conservative. That's what many see it as. But I would love to be training our teachers at the university around contemporary apologetics that says, bring faith into dialogue with life. That's all you've got to do. You can't make them believe. But you can be a person of faith and bring them to that dialogue. I'd love to see a reintroduction of modern apologetics. And if I do my job as Dean of the Academy right, within a few years, we'll be doing it, and we'll be doing it pretty well, I hope. There's a commitment. There's a KPI for you, Tanya. You've been after one.
I think we have one last question from the back of the room. Thank you, June.
David, not so much for you to answer this question tonight, but I'd be interested in your reflections upon it at a later date. To me, I was interpreting a lot of your reflections and the implications for Catholic leaders today, like if we're appointing leaders and if we're looking towards formation of leaders. But I also had in my mind, how do we support, form for leaders as a community of leaders to be together in that point of differences, the point of tension, the point of discernment, the point of wisdom?
Thank you, Jude. And it is something actually on our agenda, because the important thing to remind ourselves of is you can't be a discerning leader if you don't have the community experience. You cannot discern on your own. And hence, you know, I think like the rule of St. Benedict talks beautifully about what the individual should be and what the individual should be collectively. But yeah, it's do we have the structures? Do we have the space? Do we have the mechanism to do it? Well, there's some, in my experience of being a Catholic school leader, there are some opportunities. But it's going to be more important for us, I think. Thank you, Jude.
Thanks once again, David, and thanks looking around the room, looking at the people around the room who've led the development of Catholic principles in the past and currently. I'm sure you came into the room with a set of values that have shaped your teaching and continue to shape your teaching, and I think we're not walking away from this thinking the same way because of this, what I would call an inspirational address this evening. You took us back to those were the days, my friend, and that was a fabulous way. And I thought, where's this leading? Then you clearly articulated all of the dilemmas and the challenges of the landscape for Catholic leaders today. And I think that we all feel very much we are Catholic leaders ourselves, but particularly in schools, the diversities, the dilemmas, the challenges. But you didn't leave us in a negative black space. And thank you for that. As I said earlier, your deep reading and your deep thinking really gives us hope. You talked about reconstituting, finding reasonable frameworks, constant discernment, engagement, prayer, reflection. And I think this does give us a sense of hope for the future, to imagine a new reality for Catholic leaders. And so I'm bringing this to a conclusion this evening by affirming, you know, the hopes and dreams that you've given for us tonight, but really it's just the beginning of a very new conversation that we hope to continue to have with you as leader of the Academy. So would you join with me, please, in thanking David Hall this evening for his presentation. And some of us have been celebrating the 25th anniversary since 4 o'clock this afternoon, but I would suggest we would like to continue the celebration, not only of these wise thoughts for this evening, but in as the this event was designed. So would you join us for a few drinks and a couple of nibblies outside? And thank you once again. Thanks, everyone.